Morning. Last week I had given a New Year's resolution to Jesus Community Church to be hospitable. And it's kind of interesting because through the course of a couple different meetings this week with different people and different conversations, I was reminded of two things. You know, God has asked that anyone that would be a leader in the church must be hospitable. He's also said that any of the women that are to be put on the widow's list must have a history of being hospitable. And I was pondering about, you know, hospitality and fellowship and what does that mean. And I listened to a message that actually talked about fellowship, which was kind of funny because the message really wasn't about fellowship, but there was a section in there that the pastor kind of rabbit trailed and talked about things. And he brought up something that I just want to share with you. I know a lot of you, when I said, okay, I would like you to invite people over, you went, you know, you had that like deer in the headlights look, you know, what do I even say? Well, that's the point of getting together with them, so you learn what to say. See, fellowship amongst believers is not like fellowship amongst non-believers. You know, if all you can talk about is football, that's not really the fellowship that God is calling us to. If all you can talk about is your latest knitting project, that's not really what God is calling us to. God is calling us to an intimacy, being part of one body. And the cool thing about this is, as being that we are all part of one body, we all have one thing at least in common. Jesus Christ. And we can even go a little beyond that and go, here's topic of conversation. How did you come to know him? What has he done for you? What is he doing for you? See, that's what fellowship. Fellowship, apart from the gospel, is just hanging out. Which is not bad in and of itself, but does it really do much to edify the body? Not really. I mean, if that were the case, the bars would be the best fellowship places in town. Okay? So, I want to encourage you. You have something to talk about right off the bat. The gospel. We have something in common that we don't have in common with people out there. Jesus. We have a story to tell. We have a story to tell. We have something that we can share. What part of the pit did you come out of? Because we all came out of the pit. And he reached down and pulled us out and cleaned us off. See, we all have a commonality. And so when you're thinking about inviting people over, don't stress. Remember, there's also a little scripture here you can share. I'm taking a little out of context. It says, don't worry about what you'll say. I'll give you the words in the proper time. And sometimes it feels like you're in front of your accusers when you have to come up with something to say. Trust me. There's a lot of times when I walk up to someone and I go, hi. Good to see you. And my mind is completely blank. Completely blank. So I want to encourage you. Okay? Yeah, it might be awkward for some of you people are just gifted with hospitality. You just have the knack for making a person feel welcome in your house. Bless you. Bless you for that. Let's all work towards intimacy as the body of Christ. Let's work towards fellowship. Let's work towards being hospitable. Okay? Are you encouraged or are you discouraged? Okay, you're laughing. That's not answering my question. So, Colossians chapter 3. We're starting a new portion of Paul's message today. And before we get into that portion of his message, there's some things we have to understand. Okay, so I'm going to level the playing field right here. So everybody understands where I'm coming from. Okay, because if you think I'm coming from a different area, you're not going to be able to receive what I have to say. And where I want to come from is where I believe Paul is coming from. See, we have a problem. We have many problems. But we have a problem as regards this scripture specifically. Our culture. You know, you'd be amazed. All the different things in the Bible that I've heard people disagree with. This is one of the probably top three that people get most vehement about. This little area that we're going to cover. And we need to kind of figure out why. Now, I can understand why the world would take offense at this. They don't have God's Spirit. They're supposed to take offense because God's Spirit is offensive to them. That's how it works. Okay? So you shouldn't be surprised if you talk about Scripture with someone that's not a Christian and they go, "You don't know what you're talking about." That should be the natural course. They don't have God's Spirit illuminating to them what His Word says. But if we're talking to someone in the church, if we're talking to a fellow believer, and we have a disagreement, we've got to reconcile the disagreement. And the disagreement always comes down to one of three things. You're wrong in your interpretation and your understanding. I'm wrong in my interpretation and understanding, or we're both wrong. Because God's Word is not wrong. See, that's something we have to understand. We have to, as a believer, you have to come to the point, to the place in your walk where you are willing to take His Word as truth. Not just the parts you like. Not just the parts that are comfortable. Not just the parts that are convenient. That don't require you to change too much. You have to come to the point where it's all truth. Because see, if you can't come to that point, how do you know which is and which isn't? Because if you call any of it into suspect, if you call any of it into question, you have called all of it into question. Because it says in 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture is God-breathed. All of it. So, you know, you can be like Benjamin Franklin. When he passed away, they were going through his effects and they found his Bible. And he used a black highlighter to mark the passages he didn't like. And they called it the Benjamin Franklin Bible. And there were portions, there were huge portions of it that he just disagreed with, and so he crossed out. We all do that. We all tend to do that. You know, you get to a certain passage that you don't really care for, and you just kind of, your brain goes elsewhere, or your eyes just jump down to where you know it's comfortable again. So we need to come to the understanding, one, that God's Word is truth. Two, we have to have an understanding that God's way is best. Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, really, He's the one that put this whole thing together. He knows how it works. Okay? Now, I know there are some of you guys in here that could explain the difference to me. I don't care. I know when I used to have a carburetor in my car, I had to pump it before I started it. And now that I've got fuel injectors, pumping does nothing. Okay? I don't understand why it works the way it does. I don't care. I just know I still go out to my car every morning when it's cold, and I go, and people go, "You don't need to do that. Watch this." Well, that doesn't make any difference. It's fuel injectors. I don't care. I know there's a rational reason for it, but I don't understand it. And I don't need to know how to operate the car to make the car work right. Okay? So you need to come to the understanding, one, His Word is truth. Two, that God understand how's it work. How it works. How's it works? How it works. Three, you have to understand that His plan for you is good. Okay? God's Word is not put into place to bash you. To make you feel less. To make you feel unlovable. His Word is put into effect to make us realize our desperate need for Him. To reveal the portions of Him that we need to know to have relationship with Him. Okay? So, we're going to take a look at some of the passage today. I'm just going to read through the passage. We're going to go over and just address some general things. Okay? So, Colossians chapter 3, verse 18. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ, for the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Okay? We're not going to get into all of that today. Okay? One of the things we have to keep in mind is our Bible has this really convenient topical heading division here. Okay? That's not scripture. This little in bold right here, that's not scripture. Okay? That's just man making it convenient for us to find the same place. Okay? Helping us to understand what is in that passage. Actually, it makes it really easy for us to know which parts to bleep over. Really? You know? Oh, I like this one. Okay? So, we need to understand that when we started in verse 18, Paul didn't start in verse 18. Paul was continuing from verse 17. So let's back up and look a little bit ahead of this. Okay? I'm going to go back up to verse 16. It says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in wisdom, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with thankfulness to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Wives, submit to your husbands, as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and do not be harsh with them. Do you see? Do you see the flow here? One of the things that you need to watch for with Paul is Paul tends to bring everything back to his point. And if you notice, we wrapped up here in verse 17. It says, and whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord. We jump right down here to verse 23. He goes, whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men. You see, this is all part of the same thought. Okay, this is not Paul being scatterbrained. Now, if you listen to conversations between Christy and I, we're scatterbrained. Because as I'm saying something, something else will come to mind. And I will jump over and start addressing the other thing. Which usually is pretty obvious, because the one has nothing to do with the other. Sometimes when Christy does that, it's not as obvious, because she noodles. All of her topics touch each other. And all of a sudden I realize, wait, we're not talking about the same thing. How long has it been since we were talking about the same thing? Now we got to back up and find where she and I parted ways. Okay? But that's not what's happening here. Paul is carrying on a cohesive thought. Okay? So, another thing we need to look at. When Paul addresses a specific people group, if you're not part of that people group, it's not for you. Got it? So when he says wives, which in the Greek is gune, which is a generic word for woman, but in context, always remember, scripture is always in context. When it's put to the word aner, which is the word used for husband, it defaults from woman and man to wife and husband. Okay? It's always in context. So when he says wives, husbands, mind your business. It's not for you. It's for women. For your wife. It's not for you. Okay? Paul is not putting this in here for operating instruction for you to tell your wife. Okay, otherwise he'd say, husbands, tell your wives. He's not doing that. He is speaking directly to wives. Wives, pay attention. Men, go get your coffee. Then he goes on a little bit further and he says, husbands. Okay, back to aner. This is not wives, this is husbands. Wives, you can now go get your coffee because I'm not addressing you right now. I'm addressing men. Men, pay attention. Okay? Now, one of the troubling things about this is when he says this, you better pay attention because you will be held to account to this. When he is addressing you, you will be held account to what he says to you. Why? Is Paul speaking his own words here? Does Paul ever speak his own words in here? Well, wait, Pastor Glenn, he says this one point. I, Paul, speak to you, not the Lord. So is Paul speaking his own opinion there? No. No, because it's all God breathed. God put it all in here. For a reason. For us. Okay? So, when you are reading a passage and it does not address you specifically, keep that in mind. This is not for husbands to correct the wives, nor wives to correct the husbands. It is for wives to pay attention to what God is saying to them, and it's for husbands to pay attention to what God is saying to them. And further down, children! What does that children mean? Does that mean like anyone under the age of 12? Or 18? Or what does that word mean exactly? Children. Well, it means if you have parents. If you are an offspring, it's addressing you. Kind of weird, isn't it? Because we want to automatically classify this. We get to a certain age and that doesn't apply to us anymore. That's not really what it means. Okay? Because we're all children to our parents. Now, we're all not, you know, we get to the point where we put away childish things and we take on the responsibilities of an adult. But that parent-child dynamic doesn't change. There's still a parent-child dynamic. Now, we're going to talk about that later and go into a little bit more detail and more depth on what that means. But what I want to talk about right now, we're just kind of clearing up, we're laying the groundwork. All right? So, when it addresses your people group, if you're a part of that group, pay attention. If you are not a part of that people group, be very careful. Because this is sharper than any two-edged sword. And you can cut and slice and dice your family to pieces and totally miss what God is saying. Okay? Okay. So, look at this. I haven't even opened my notes yet. I think I'm going to have to go up another font size. So, wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives. Paul a bigot? Kind of depends. Depends on your interpretation and your understanding of what he's saying. See, everybody's a bigot to somebody else. That's why Scripture tells us, don't be so easily offended. You know? Don't be so easily put off. You understand the world is going to think bad things about us because we have a moral certitude, a moral plane that we have to live on that they don't understand, they don't get. And they're going to say bad things about us. Like we're chauvinistic, we're bigots, we're narrow-minded. Yeah, well, we kind of have to be narrow-minded because the way is narrow. He's told us that. Only the few find it. The few, the proud, the finders of the way. You thought I was going somewhere else, didn't you? And what Paul is laying out here? Well, Paul's not a bigot. Let's go back to Genesis. Flip over there with me. We're going to go way back to the beginning. I want to show something. We're in Genesis chapter 3. Garden of Eden. Serpent Adam, Eve, they've had an encounter. They tasted some really good fruit, which to me is not an apple. Probably a pineapple, nectarine, something, I don't know. But they've tasted some really good fruit, and they've become enlightened. They've had their eyes opened. And Eve looked at Adam and said, "Would you please put some clothes on? Why do you walk around like that?" And so Adam went and got himself some fig leaves, and they dressed themselves in their height. And God comes into the garden, and he's looking for them. Now, it's kind of funny, because we know that God is omniscient, that he knows everything. But he's walking through the garden, and he's calling Adam, like he doesn't know where he is. Why do you suppose God is calling Adam? If he knows everything, he knows he's hidden right behind that bush right over there. Why is he calling him? Just like he calls us, to give us opportunity to answer. Not for his sake, for our sake. And they come out and they're wearing leaves, which God thinks is kind of odd. Why are you wearing such ugly clothing? Well, because we're naked. Well, who told you you were naked? And the truth comes out. Now, it comes out the way we like to present it, in the way that puts us in the best light. Well, God, I'm wearing clothes because that woman that you gave me tricked me. And the woman goes, "Not me, it's the serpent. The serpent, it was him, it, whatever." When the truth of the matter was, they were told what they could and could not do. And knowing what they could not do, they did it anyway. Okay? That's the truth of the matter. And so we're jumping down here, and I'm going to point out something very specifically. God's already dealt with the serpent. We're down in verse 16. So we're in Genesis 3, 16. "To the woman he said, 'I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you.'" Now think about this for a minute. You see, God is laying out what they have called on themselves. God didn't just go through his book of terrible things you can do to people and find something appropriate. God is laying out for them what they have done to themselves. This is a result of eating this fruit. Okay. Now, any of you that have gone through childbirth knows the first part of this to be true. Any of you husbands that have been with your wives as they went through childbirth knows this first part to be true. And they don't give the husbands any drugs. I know. That's the doctor calling to ask for drugs. I'm just going to stand there so she feels really embarrassed. So we know the first part is true. Okay? I'm going to greatly increase your pain. Now, did you ever wonder about this? I'm going to greatly increase. You know, he didn't say, "I'm going to give you pain." She was already going to have pain, but she had no children in the garden that we're aware of. So all she ever knew was greatly increased pain. Anybody ever pick up on that? No woman has ever known what it's supposed to be like to deliver children. "Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." Now let's think about creation. Okay? God created man. He made him the husband over all of the things on this earth. He put him in charge. He said, "Take care of these things. You are my steward. Take care of them." And then God said, "It's not good for him to be alone. I will find for him, I will make him a suitable helper." Somebody to help him with his work. Now contrast that with what comes out as part of the curse. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. See, if there's anyone that's a bigot, it's us in our sin. Because it was our sin that caused things to get so out of whack, so twisted. Remember the knothole of the cross? When we come to the cross and we look through the knothole, we see things turned as they're supposed to be. We see things brought back around to the way, the shape, the design that God intended. And it looks weird to us because we spent all of our lives with things twisted. And the abnormal became normal. It doesn't make sense to us sometimes that that's the way it's supposed to be. This is one of those things. So, your desire shall be for your husband. And we're going to go into this a little bit later. I have a series that I want to do on family relationships, the family dynamic. But let me just share this little portion with you. You know the word, your desire shall be for your husband, this little passage right here? Really, that's not the idea that it conveys. The English conveys this so very poorly. Really, what they're talking about is not, you'll want your husband, you're going to want him. What it's really saying is you're going to want his place. Okay? You're going to want his position. Okay? Because the curse wouldn't be that you're going to want him. She already wanted him in the garden. How much of that was because she had no options? I don't know. God's smart in how he does things. He made it easy for Eve. You got Adam. There you go. I think as good fathers, we should be doing that for our children. You have one choice. There he is. It doesn't work that way anymore. So, her desire was already for her husband. So what really, the idea in the Hebrew is, you want his position, you want his place. Okay? And he will rule over you. Now, the helper concept is gone now. Now we move to where man is no longer aner. He's gone to kurios, which is another word used for husband. It's actually translated Lord. Okay? We've gone from a position of working together side by side to the man in front and the woman behind. And we see that. We see that all throughout history. Goodness gracious. Look in history and see how women were treated. And you'll see the effect of this curse. Okay. You'll see the effect. Okay. Now we're going to jump way ahead, thousands of years ahead, going back to Colossians. Alright, so we have the cross. We have the cross. And we get to glimpse how it was supposed to work. So, Paul says, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. We have another problem, this word submit. See, we have a cultural identity with submit that is negative. As soon as I say submit, how many of you thought negative? How many of you went, eh? I do. And I've studied this. Come on, honestly, how many of you so heard submit and went, pfft? Okay, we got about six honest people. And there's probably a bunch of you other ones that weren't paying attention. See, we have this idea that submission is a bad thing. Okay? We have this concept that in order to submit, you're placing yourself under someone else's authority. You become a doormat. We have to fix that. And we're going to fix it by one of two things. There's two things that need to be addressed. First, see, Paul doesn't just stop with submit. He doesn't end there. If this passage read, wives, submit to your husbands, children, obey your parents, bondservants, obey your masters, then we'd have something to discuss of an entirely different nature, but it doesn't. So he goes, wives, husbands, wives, husbands, children, parents, slaves, masters. See, there's always both sides of the equation. There's never just one side given here. It's addressing both. Why? Because both need to be addressed. Both need to be addressed. So first, let's look at submit. The word in the Greek is hupotasso, okay? And it carries with it two different but very similar ideas. One, it's used in a military term, okay? And it's talking about rank. Generals are at the top, and then the colonels, and the majors, and the captains, and the lieutenants, and the enlisted men. There's rankings, okay? And in order for an army to work properly, there has to be a chain of command. Somebody has to be the one that bears the responsibility. Okay? And so, if you're lowly private, and your sergeant tells you, go do this, and you go do this, and somebody says, hey, why are you doing that? Well, because he told me to. The buck goes that way. They go to the sergeant and says, hey, why is private so-and-so doing that? My lieutenant told me to. Lieutenant, why? And up it goes, till somewhere it stops. Okay? See, it's not just a matter of having authority, it's having accountability. It's having responsibility. It's not just carte blanche. Husbands, you got these wives and children underneath you, do what you want, they're yours. Feel it. Go. No. Alright? Not in here. That's not in here. You will not see that in here. And if you see that in here, I want you to show it to me and I want to see the translation. Because it's not supposed to be in here. So we need to understand submission. Okay? Hupotasso. There's the military term, but there's also a civilian term. Did you understand that? There's a civilian application. And in that context, it is choosing to work together for the common good. Choosing to place yourself under authority for the common good. Do you understand what that means? We're going to have a work day at the church. Everybody comes in and does their project. How well do you think that would work without somebody deciding what the projects were and how they were going to be done? I would love to have put those cabinets in. They wouldn't have looked anything like that. Nothing like that. When we do church work days, boy, I tell you, I can catch. Yeah, I do that all the time. Fetch and carry. Instead of catch and ferry. I can do that too because they toss things to me as well. I can get you a tool as quick as anybody. Don't ask me to use it. They asked me to help with the siding over here. I put four rows up and they had to fix three of them. Josh, I won't tell them you were helping me. So they decided at that point I was better fetching and carrying. Okay? See, the idea is we work together for the common good. Now you think fetching and carrying isn't a big deal, but when they're up on three flights of scaffolding and all the material are down on the ground, all of a sudden my job becomes kind of important. Because I save a lot of time. Because they got the guy, they're going, zinking, zinking, zinking. Okay, these need to go up. And I pick them up, and I walk them up. And all they got to do is bend over and pick them up, and thunk, in they go. Imagine how lousy it would have been if they had to go, okay, well, we got to do it this far and this far. We'd still be siding. We'd still be siding. Hupotasso, willingly putting yourself under authority for the good of what needs to be done. Okay? choosing to do that. Now, we're going to come back to this. Husbands, let's bash on you for a little bit. Husbands, love your wives. Now, you know there's another book that parallels Colossians very similarly, very closely, right? Ephesians, the book of Ephesians. Let's flip over to Ephesians for just a minute. And we're going to go to a little bit more explanation as to what Paul is talking about here. So we're in Ephesians chapter 5. So I'm going to start in verse 22. We're going to read through 22. We're going to go on down, okay? It says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Sound very similar, doesn't it? But then he goes on into an explanation. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands. Okay, now wives, this is not for you. Husbands, this is for you. All right? Husbands, love your wives. How? How am I supposed to love my wife? Man, I love her. Man, I told her when we were dating I loved her. I even said it right up there at the altar. If it ever changes, I'll let her know. There's love for you. Yeah, Dennis, I was thinking of you. Oh, but Paul doesn't end there. He goes on. He makes further explanation. He says, as Christ loved the church. He doesn't stop there. Okay, well, as Christ loved the church. Well, that's pretty suspect. I mean, how does Christ love the church? I mean, what is... Oh, let's go on, because Paul doesn't end there. He says, and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are all members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother, hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Guys, God has called us to be the Christ image to our family. Okay? He has called us to love and sacrifice of ourselves for the betterment of our families, our wives, our children. See, we want to look at, personally, I don't really have a problem looking at the wives part of it because that's Christy's responsibility. And I can help point out where she's failing in those. It's very easy for me to say, my love is a machine. You didn't do that, right? But see, that, you know, that's not what we're called to. What I'm called to right here is that I love her as Christ has loved his church, sacrificially. Putting her needs above my needs. Do you get that? Do you understand that? See, what wife would not be willing to submit to a man who always put her first? Who loved her, agapeo, unconditionally, not predicated on anything that she has done. Not even on her ability to do anything. But based on what is birthed inside of you. The love that God has for you. See, that's the love that we have for our wives. And when Paul says, husbands, love your wives, it's not just hang out with them. It's not even just tolerating them. It's not cohabitating with them. It is giving up the right that you have to yourself to take upon her needs. Do you understand that? Ooh, ouch. See, one of the things that we have to understand, we hear it, we play with it up here, but we don't ever get it rooted down here, is that God has called us to quit being us. Jesus says that if you would follow me, jump on the bandwagon and to town we go, we're going to have a good old time. Because I like you just the way you are. No. He says, if you would follow me, you must take up your cross. What does that mean? Crucify yourself. Put to death the yuck that is you. Daily. Every day. We don't get, you know, I love my exercise program. Because it's when I want. You'd be amazed how often I want when I'm standing looking in the mirror, and how often I don't when I'm standing looking at the treadmill. Because something changes from the bathroom to the treadmill. We don't have a choice in this, people. If we are His, we've got to start living as He lived. Now, think about this. Christ, seated in heaven, being in His very nature, Almighty God, He is God. And He sees the need of His church. Well, how can that be? Because the church wasn't even founded until Acts, because God sees all things at all times. And God, looking in eternity, sees the need of His church. He sees the need of His people. And He says, this is what I've got to do. I'm going to go and do what they can't. And He takes on human flesh. But He doesn't stop there. He takes on the flesh of a servant. He upatosolus. He submits Himself to the will of the Father. And He comes down. Well, let's think about this a little bit further. Let's look at His ministry. What is He doing? He goes around, He preaches God. But He doesn't just preach God. Anybody can preach God. There's a lot of people, they had a bunch of people at that time that were preaching God. But what were they not doing? They were not meeting the people at their need. What did Jesus do? He met them where they were. Think about this for a minute, people. This is a man who touched lepers. Something that was so abhorrent to the mindset at the time. Because now he became unclean. And he had to go through the ritual process to make himself clean again. But seeing them, he had compassion for them. And he touched them. He reached out and touched them at their need. And then once they were healed, he moralized. And he spiritualized. And he gave them a perfect 3-point message. And a 12-step process to be holy. No, he didn't. He loved them. You know what he said most often in any of those situations? And he didn't even say this often. What did he say? He said, go and don't sin anymore. Go and stop your sinning. You know, we think we got it so much better. As if we have some kind of intellect that he was lacking. Because somebody comes into our church with a need, and we go through, well, you have to do this, and this, and this, and this, and then we'll see. And we want to put conditions on these things. But Jesus didn't do that. He met them right where they were, at their need. Okay? So, here's God, made in human flesh, serving, giving up everything that is His by right. By right. By right. I mean, think about this for a minute. How ironic is this? Peter's out and they say, hey, Peter, we've noticed you haven't paid the temple tax. And Peter comes in and he's troubled. And Jesus knows exactly what's going on. It says, hey, Rock. What's up? Well, the temple tax. Hey, you know what? In order that all things might be right, go down and go fishing. And the first fish you get, pull it out, there's going to be a coin in there. It'll pay your tax and mine. How bizarre is that? Jesus is going to pay a tax to himself. Do you get that? He's paying the 2 drachma tax for the temple that goes right back to service for him. So here's Jesus, who has the right to adoration from everything. Not just every person, everything. What do we tell them? Hey, if they don't cry out, the very rocks will cry out. But he's submitting himself. Not only does he submit himself, but he subjects himself to lies, to false accusation, to abuse, to horrific bodily damage, such that he was no longer recognizable as human. Willingly. Okay? Now keep that in mind, because see, that's what you and I are called. See, if we really understand Jesus, then we'll understand that submission is a beautiful and glorious thing. Jesus goes so far as to say, hey, you want to be great in my kingdom? Be the least. Hupotasso. Be a servant. Wash feet. Wash feet. See, this is two sides to the same coin, husbands and wives. Wives, Jesus isn't calling you to a place of less. He's calling you to a fantastic, honored, and esteemed place in his body. If you really believe that in order to be great, you have to be a servant, and he's asking you to be a servant to your husband, has he not called you to an absolutely beautiful and fantastic thing? Has he not? I mean, this is, you know, some of you might live with jerks. I don't know, because I don't see what goes on day in and day out at your house. I know in our house, sometimes I can be a jerk. Because I don't want, by golly, I don't want homemade pizza tonight. And I can be a jerk. Now see, God didn't just abandon Christy when I'm being a jerk. Because as she responds in the way and the manner that he has called her to respond in, he is honoring her and he is esteeming her, and her treasures are abundant in heaven because she is doing what he has commanded of her. Husbands, that whole love picture that we had of Jesus, that's what you're called to. To come down. To take yourself off your lofty perch of manhood and serve. Serve. You know, men are usually really good at serving, especially like when we have work days. Boy, they get it done. But for some reason, we have a difficult time serving in our house. To find the needs and meet the needs. It's like, you know, when we get home, we're free to be our natural jerky self. No. God put this thing together to grow us, to kill us, to help us weed apart and get rid of the ugly stuff that is us, that we might take on his nature, the nature of Christ, right? Right? That's what marriage is all about. The two becoming one flesh, what, you think God is just into genetics? God's up there one day thinking, how can I take this and make something really cool out of it? I know, we'll just fuse them together. God's purposes and plans are so much bigger than we even fathom. Okay? Now, I know some of you think, oh, well, what if my spouse is unsaved? They didn't neglect that either. You see, in Peter, Paul also addresses women. Now, what does he tell them? Christian, would you quote that for me?
In the same way, submit yourself to husbands, not so they won't be won over, not with words, but when they see the reverence of your life.
Your gentle and quiet spirit. See, there's this weird dichotomy that comes into place when a woman becomes a Christian and her husband isn't. And I've seen it at play over and over and over again. I saw it in my own family. My mom was saved for 11 years before my dad ever came to the Lord. Okay. And there was this kind of superior attitude. Which, if you ever feel superior as a Christian, check where you're at as a Christian. Remember what Paul says? Consider others better than yourself. Better. He doesn't even qualify others. He just says, consider others. He doesn't just say, those that make more money than you. Or those that are further along in life or have more of a position of prestige. He says, consider others better than yourself. But women, who I don't know why God does what he does, but he made women verbal. They talk. Okay? That can be a good thing. It can be a bad thing. Women out-talk men 99% of the time. Okay? Quite honestly, a lot of arguments a Christian I get into, I give up because I'm out of words. I surrender. White flag goes up. Just let me have quiet. I want to be done. Victory is yours. But Peter says, not that they would be won over with words, but that they might be won over by your reverent spirit, by your gentle and quiet spirit. That you're not lashing out on them. You need to be in church. You need to be going to the brothers' meeting. You need Jesus. No, a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of much worth. Okay? All right. Men, what about your unsaved wives? What about your unsaved wife? Love them, love them, love them. Love them as Christ has loved the church. Because see, when Christ loved first, there was no church. You understand that, right? All he had was disciples. There was no church. Especially not like we have here. There was no regular fellowship meeting thing. That didn't come till Acts. After his ascension. But he loved them. And he laid down his life and he put their needs ahead of his needs. Even when he was going for some me time. Me time. There is no me time in Scripture. Did you understand that? Oh, I just need a little me time. No, you don't. You need God time. Because when Jesus needed me time, what did he do? He went and prayed. He re-energized by fellowshipping with the Father. By isolating himself from the noise, seeking the solitude, and spending time in worship with the Father. Okay? That was me time for him. He didn't go to the spa. Believe it or not, they had spas. They did. And it was not only acceptable, but it was normal for men to go to. He didn't go hunting. He didn't do the things that we think of when it's me time. He went and isolated himself and worshiped the Father. Okay. Even in then, when they interrupted him, and they came and they bugged him, and they plagued him, and they, gimme, gimme, gimme! I tell you what, you all thank God daily that he didn't send me on your behalf. Because, like, maybe once that would have worked. After that, it'd be like, get it yourself! I need some me time! You whiners! Yeah, God knows what he's doing, right? That's why he didn't send me, and he didn't send you. That's why he had to come. Okay? So, wives, submit to your husbands in everything. Okay? Husbands, I know all your ears, all the husbands' ears perked up at that. Love your wives. Now, don't just love them how you understand love. Love as Christ has loved the church. Gave himself up for her. See, this thing works so much better when each is doing what they're supposed to be doing. I tell you what, it falls apart fast when you start holding each other to account. It gets ugly. Ugly. I blunted my sword beating Christy with it. Woman, the Bible says you're supposed to submit. Yeah, it also says you're supposed to love. I just flatlined that one. Beep. And we abused each other for years with that. If it's talking to you, pay attention. Understand that this is truth. All of it. Genesis to Revelation. All of it. Understand that our culture is opposed to this truth. It resists it. It works against it. It does everything it can to make this look foolish. But that's okay, because God chose the foolish things in the world to confound one eyes. Okay? Understand that his plan for you is good. Good. That he desires good things for you. Alright? And when husband and wife become one, and you're jerks, and you're selfish, and you want everything your way, he understands that. One of the most marvelous things that God ever did for us is speak to Christy very early in our marriage. Okay? Because she told him. We prayed a lot before we got married. A lot. We really earnestly sought God's will on what we should do. We spent a lot of time in Scripture. We shared with each other. We prayed together. We prayed separately. We got married and thought we were just going to be in bliss forevermore. Wrong. Oh, were we deceived? Because somehow or another, I missed the scriptures in here that said it's going to be tough. Paul even goes so far as to say, I would spare you this hardship. Because things got hard and they got ugly. And at one point, Christy laid before God, you blew it. Because this is not the man for me. I cannot be married to this man. I cannot stay with him. And God spoke to her. And he told her, I did not call you to be married based on who you are. I called you to be married based on who I'm making you into. And there was a lot of ugly that needed to go away in our lives. They're still ugly. Oh, a week ago, Christy and I had a lamb bang of a fight. And I scratched my head thinking, what was that even about? Who cares? Why is that an issue? Well, whereas that used to be a regular event, that's the first one that we've had in, I don't even know how long. Months, maybe even a year. I don't know. It quite honestly, it appalled me how quickly I got ugly. See, that was a regular occurrence. God is making us into something better. Making us into something better. And I think maybe that came along to remind me how far we've come, how gracious he's been to us, how much change he's actually wrought in our lives. So, Wives, pay attention when he's talking to you, because he's talking to you for your good, to bless you, to have good plans for you. Don't let the world lie to you and tell you that what God wants for you is dumb or less or ugly. What does the world know? They are rushing headlong into hell. They are doing everything they can to not only deny the existence of God, but to disprove Him. Which I can't fathom. If He doesn't exist, why do you need to disprove anything? They're not satisfied with saying He doesn't exist. They've got to try and confound this and resist this. If He doesn't exist, this has no meaning. What does it bother you? Husbands, love your wives. Love them in a way that is understandable to them. Love them in a way that they can receive, that will make their heart glow. Put their needs above your needs. Submit yourself under God, as Christ submitted Himself under God, that good things might come from that relationship. That beautiful things might come from that relationship. That the divorce rate in church would no longer be the same as the divorce rate in the world. That we might have people in the church married till death do them part. And see the beauty that God has in that. Amen? Mm-hmm.